about this morning's message so that we're all on board. I'm going to give you some immediate context as we're reading chapter 31 and 32. We're going to go backwards and give you a larger, broader context whenever we go back to chapter 28 for a little bit. And we're going to try to look at the big picture of God, because that's how God's told me to preach. I want you to preach my big picture. I want my people to be able to see the big plan. And then also we're going to come back down and we're going to try to bring it into our individual lives and how this text can affect our individual lives. Amen? We're in the book of Genesis, and we're going to be in chapter 32 first. So the main character of our story, you know, we're once again, Genesis is narrative literature. I like to bring this up because the Bible has different types of literature in it. Narrative tells a story. It's like a narrator telling a story. And it's more than a story, but it is a story. And in narratives, there are always characters. And characters cause the action of the story to move. And our main character in this story is Jacob. And if you're familiar with Jacob, he was Abraham's grandson. And if you're familiar with Abraham, he was the one, there was no nation called Israel, right? And God called Abraham out from really Babylon, current day Iraq, and said, come out from your father's house and I'm going to make you a nation. And God did. He held to his promise and he made a nation out of the man named Abraham. Abraham had Isaac, Isaac had Jacob. And ultimately, from the nation of Israel, God gave us Jesus. We're going to see that God's plan has all along been the same. To give us a redeemer to pay the price for our sin. Amen. And in every story and in every instance, we can find that if we look for it properly, because this is the story of God. Salvation is his story, salvation history. Amen. And so I want you to know a little bit about the character Jacob, though. His very name means supplanter. It means heel smasher. It's another word for deceiver, because he was a twin. In case you didn't know that, he had a twin brother named Esau. And even while they were in their mother's womb, whenever they were coming out, when Esau came out, Jacob had a hold of his heel. And he didn't want to let go because, see, Jacob didn't want Esau to be the firstborn, because even in the womb, the Lord told their mother, Rebecca, she said, there's a war going on the inside of me. What's going on? He said, God told her there are two nations on the inside of you. And Jacob wanted so badly to be the firstborn to where he would get all of the promises. But God already knew that Jacob was going to be the firstborn. Yeah. And let me tell you why. Because Esau would ultimately despise the things of God, to make a long story short. And you know, God already understands that. God's not pre-electing people. He's not saying, "Any, mini, miny, mo, this sinner gets to stay, but this sinner gets to go." No, that's not how he did. God has a plan. And the plan is Jesus Christ and him crucified. And those that are willing to come in will be saved. Hallelujah. But at the same time, God knows who's going to come in and who's not. Esau was one of those people who he despised the things of God. He did not care about his birthright. He sold it for a bowl of lentils. You ever ate lentils? They're okay when my mother-in-law cooks them, but they're not that good. You don't want to sell your birthright for a bowl of lentils, right? He sold his birthright for a bowl of lentils. But you know what? Jacob got involved and he deceived his brother. Jacob was involved with his mom in deceiving her. And I have to tell you something. Because of Jacob bare true to his own name, the character of Jacob was that he would take matters into his own hands. He would figure things out in his own logic and intellect, and then he would try to take matters into his own hands to fix his circumstances. That ought to be ringing true in somebody's heart and head right now. I mean, how many times have we in our own lives, whether it be finances, relationship, whatever it is, the things that we find, we take matters, we figure things out in our own intellect, we take matters into our own hands, we try to fix our own circumstances, and what we end up finding is a bigger mess than what we were ever in before. God wants to bring us to a place where we don't just believe that he's real for tomorrow, where we get this dance on streets of gold, but he wants us to believe he's real for today, and that we put him in the midst of our circumstances, and that we watch him, amen, begin to move, begin to shift things around according to his plan and according to his purposes for the big picture, but also for our individual lives. So I just wanted you to see a little bit about the story of Jacob. Now, the last thing that Jacob did before we read some of this, because Jacob's on a journey right now. We're going to kind of do like Hollywood. We're going to flash back a little bit. But Jacob's on a journey right now. And the journey that he's on is he went to go find himself a wife. All right? He went to go find himself a wife, but the reason that he had to leave so suddenly was because him and his mom came up with a ploy, and they deceived the father, Isaac. Isaac was growing old in age, dim in sight. He could not see anymore. and he was ready to bless Esau, but God had promised that Jacob would receive the blessing. So Jacob, instead of waiting on the timing of God, come on somebody, yeah. instead of waiting on the timing, because had he waited, I can assure you, Esau would have ended up throwing it away. Now, God doesn't waste anything, and he knows how to work even in man's failure, amen, because he's sovereign. But instead of waiting on the timing of God, Jacob took matters into his own hands, and they sewed up a fur sleeve, and because Esau was hairy. You go ask them kids over there, I told them about Jacob, they'll tell you Esau was hairy, he had red hair all over his body. And Jacob's mama said, you go in there, and you're gonna tell your daddy that you're Esau, and you're gonna get the blessing. And Jacob said, I'm smooth. Esau's hairy. Daddy's gonna figure it out, and it's not gonna be good for me. That's all right, I got this under control. And she sewed him up some fur, and they slapped that on his arm, and he went up in there and rubbed up on his daddy, and his dad thought he was Esau and gave him the blessing. Well, when Esau's gonna find out, dude, Esau's a hunter. He's like a big old mountain of a man full of red hair, and he's mad now. And so Jacob realizes it, and he takes off, and he's going to find himself a wife, okay? Well, now, in the situation that we're about to read, Jacob is leaving. He's been gone now for 20 years, and he's gotten more than one wife. We'll get into that a little bit. And he's got a big old family. He's got a big old herd, and he's traveling, and he finds himself in the midst of a circumstance. And the only thing Jacob really knows how to do is to try to take matters into his own hands. And you'll see this in the story, but something happens. There's a transition in this first part that we're going to read that forever changed Jacob's life. In verse 6 of chapter 32, it says, and the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, we came to thy brother Esau, and also he cometh to meet thee, and 400 men with him. Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed, and he divided the people that was with him, and the flocks and herds and the camels into two bands. Now let's skip to verse 24. And Jacob was left alone. I'm sorry, let's go up to verse 22. And he rose up that night and took his two wives and his two women servants and his 11 sons and passed over the ford Jabbok. Now, to be fair to Dinah, you got to understand that he also had a daughter. Her name was Dinah, and she was already born. For whatever reason, they don't mention her here, but all 11 of his sons are born. The only one that's not born yet is Benjamin. Okay, so Joseph's a baby. Dinah, the one sister, is there, and they crossed over the Jabbok River. And he took them and sent them over the brook and sent them over that he had. And Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh. What that's talking about is that the way the Bible is describing it first is that a man showed up. Now, what we're going to realize is that it's really God. It's what you would, I would call this a Christophany. It's a physical manifestation in the Old Testament of the Christ showing up in the version of a man. And, Christophany, meaning a presentation of Jesus in the Old Testament. And at first, we're just told he's a man and that there's a wrestling match that's going on. But later, we're told that it's really God that Jacob wrestled with. And it's when it says that he could not prevail against him, what it's really saying right there is that God, who was wrestling with Jacob, could not prevail against Jacob. Now, what we got to understand is this, and I probably should have waited till later to preach this, but, you know, it's not that God couldn't snatch Jacob around and sling him on the ground. That's not the issue that's going on here. Just as in your life, the same thing was going on in Jacob's life. God made you with a free will. And the truth of the matter is that God wants us to submit ourselves willingly to his will. And many times, he's having a difficult time prevailing, but it's not him and his power and his strength. It's because he refuses to transgress our will. And what he wants us to do is to willingly surrender our will to him. And so when the Lord realized that he couldn't prevail against Jacob, it says he touched him in the hollow of his thigh, meaning in the deep middle part. He did something to the joint, probably the hip joint, and it changed forever the anatomy of Jacob's leg, okay? And so that's what's happening. Jacob's having a wrestling match. And he said, touched him in the hollow of his thigh, and his thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And that was really the Lord speaking. And he said, I will not let thee go except you bless me. So the Lord said, the day breaketh, go ahead and let me go. And Jacob said, no, I'm holding on. I want a blessing. Now, I got to tell you, at this point in time, we're about to get into a little bit more. Jacob's got two wives. He's got 11 sons. He's got one daughter. And he's got a big old flock of cattle. And he's headed now out of the place where he's been. And he's heading towards the promise that God's given him. The text doesn't tell me exactly what kind of blessing Jacob's looking for. I don't really know what Jacob's concept of a blessing is. To be perfectly honest with you, many times people's concept of a blessing is always surrounding material possessions. It's always surrounding finances. And I don't know if Jacob's wanting a little bit more stuff. He might be. But let me tell you, the blessing that he receives may not have exactly been the blessing that he was expecting. Nevertheless, God knows how to bless his people, and he really does know what it is that you need better than you yourself know what you need. Amen. Yes. Praise God. And so what ended up happening was he said, let me go. Jacob says, nope, don't, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And this is the blessing. And he said unto him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. So you're no longer going to be called heel snatcher, supplanter, deceiver, but instead your name's now going to be Israel. We're not going to preach it, we're just going to read it. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed. And Jacob asked him and said, tell me, I pray thee, thy name. So now Jacob wants to know his name. And he said, wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name? And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel. For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. And as he passed over Peniel, the sun rose upon him, and he halted upon his thigh. The word halted means he limped. So from that point forward, Jacob had a limp in his leg. All right, let's go back to chapter 31. So what we're doing is now we're going to do a little bit of a flashback. And I told you the origin of the story was that Jacob had originally deceived his brother Esau, right? And that now he's been on the run. And what happened was that he ended up going back to the place where Abraham originally came from. Where Abraham came from, where Abraham found a bride for his son Isaac, Rebekah. As a matter of fact, I mean, there's no reason not to draw it real quick on the board just so that we're all clear here. That, you know, whenever we're talking about the place of, known as Israel, I always like to draw this little map. This is the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, the Dead Sea. Israel lies in this strip of land. This is the Mediterranean Sea right here. Israel is this small strip of land right here. This was originally Canaan land before. It was called the land of Canaan before it was changed. The name was changed to Israel. All right, and you see where the name Israel came from, right? His name was Jacob. It was changed to Israel. He had 12 sons. They were the 12 tribes of Israel. And so this is the land of Canaan. This is the promised land. This is the land of Israel that God promised to Abraham. He said, I'm going to make you a people, and I'm going to give you a place. Amen? And so this is what they're looking forward to this. But the big picture for you and I is that this is the place that Jesus would be birthed from. Because God's got one plan in mind. Hallelujah. He's here to redeem sinners to come in and be part of the family of God. But listen to me. Abraham was called out of this place over here. It's called Mesopotamia, the land between the rivers, the Tigris and the Euphrates, a place called Ur of the Chaldees, southern Iraq. And so this is where Abraham was called out of. This is where they went back and they found Rebekah, because Laban lived over here. And Laban was a relative. And Laban's daughters were Rachel and Leah. And Jacob, they knew, they said, don't take wives from this area here. We're not going to get into all that. We've preached it before. It's too much to talk about. Don't take your wife from here. They got ungodly people up in this place. Really, really, really ungodly. Don't connect yourself to ungodly people in this way, shape, or form, because they will ruin your life, for lack of better words. Go get a wife from over here. So Jacob's on the run, and he goes over here to get himself a wife, and he ends up with two wives. He falls in love with Rachel. He sees her. She's beautiful. He wants her to be his wife. And he says, listen, Laban, I'm willing to work for this woman. Like, I'll work for you 7 years in order to get this woman right here. Well, Laban deceives him. See, you can't go all of your life deceiving people like Jacob and not think that you're never going to get deceived.
Amen.
You can't go all of your life handling your business a certain way and not think that it's not ever going to come back on you. What you reap, you shall also sow. It's going to happen, right? Now, I'm not saying that the Lord's not merciful, because he is. And many times, if we will begin to heed his voice, hallelujah, he begins to have mercy and grace, and he gives us strength, right? He gives us guidance and counsel, all right? So, but on the wedding night, it's not Rachel. It's Leah. It's the one who the Bible calls her tender-eyed. We don't know exactly what that means. We don't know if it makes your eye feel tender when you look at her. We don't know if one of her eyes did something funny. We don't know. But it isn't the one. It isn't the one that Jacob wanted. And so he's really not happy about the situation. He's like, no, I wanted Rachel. And he's like, yeah, but we can't give you the younger one first. We got to give you the older one first. And so Jacob's like, okay, well, I'll work another 7 years for Rachel, but you just got to give her to me. All right. And so that's what happens. A week goes by, and he says, fulfill your week to Leah, then I'll go ahead and give you Rachel, but you owe me 7 more years. And so he does. He gets both of his wives, and then he also works another 6 years, we learned, for the cattle. So he works a total of 20 years for Laban. And, and through the two wives and through the two handmaidens that they had, Jacob has ultimately 12 offspring. And these 12 boys and one daughter, so 13 offspring. And these 12 boys, once again, become the 12 tribes of Israel, which ultimately becomes the nation of Israel, right? And so I just wanted you to be aware of that. And so what we just read is that Jacob now is leaving that place, and he's headed back to Canaan, the land of promise that God had promised him, whenever he's about to run into his brother Esau again. Now we're flashing back, and we're going to read all of chapter 31, because I think it's got some good stuff in there. And it's going to tell us more about the story. It's after he's married the wives. It's after he's had the children. And it's kind of at the end of that part of the season of his life where he's done what he was supposed to do for Laban. And now God's saying, you know what? I see what's going on. You're not being treated properly. It's time for you to get your stuff and to head out. I'm going to take care of you, okay? And so here we are in chapter 31. Actually, we're going to go back. I want you to see something. Let me just say this too. In all of that, in that time frame, whenever, because this is important for the message, in that time frame, whenever he was having children, Leah wanted Jacob's love so bad that she was willing to do, she tried to do everything that she could in order to get that man to love her. She knew that he wanted children, and she was having children. Let me tell you, she was productive. She had 6 of her own, and her handmaid had 2. And everything that she ever tried to do, Jacob still loved Rachel. And I just wanted to make that point to you, because see, everybody in this story has something going on. Everybody in this story is trying to hold on to something real hard and real tight. And the reality of it is that what we need to learn in the end is there's only one thing that we're supposed to really try to be holding on to. Amen. And so it says right here, and if we go back to chapter 30, verse 27, it's talking about Laban. Because I want you to see, because Laban's going to hold on to some stuff too before it's over with. And I want you to see what's really happening. In verse 27 of chapter 30 of Genesis, it says, and Laban said unto him, talking about Jacob, I pray thee, I'm begging you, if I have found favor in your eyes, tarry. In other words, stay here, for I have learned by experience that the Lord has blessed me for your sake. Don't leave, Jacob. Please stay. Because your presence here, the God that you serve, I'm getting a major blessing out of this deal. All right? And he said, appoint me your wages, and I will give it. Whatever you want, Jacob, I'll pay you. And he said unto him, thou knowest how I have served thee, and how your cattle was with me. For it was little which thou hadst before I came. You didn't have much, and it is now increased into a multitude. And the Lord has blessed you since my coming, and now when shall I provide for my own house also? And he said, what shall I give you? And Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. I'm not asking anything for free. Isn't that refreshing to hear? You know, back in the day, like, you ain't got to give me nothing for free. I'm going to work for it. Amen?
Amen.
He says, and what shall I give you? Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. If thou wilt do this thing for me, I will again feed and keep thy flock. Now, when it's all said and done, this is what Jacob said. He said, I want the gristled ones, the speckled ones, and the ring straight ones. What does that mean? Ring straight means has stripes. Speckled means has little specks. What was the other word I said? Spotted. The spotted ones means big old spots. In other words, they were not the solid colored cattle. I want all the ones that have stripes, specks, or spots. From this point moving forward, when a calf bears a child, if it's got spots, specks, or streaks, it's mine and it's not yours. All right? Well, now we're going to read in chapter 31. And he heard the words of Laban's sons, saying, Jacob has taken away all that was our father's, and of that which was our father's hath he gotten all this glory. Uh-oh, we got a problem. Verse 2, and Jacob beheld the countenance of Laban, and behold, it was not toward him as before. The word countenance means a facial expression. It means the way that somebody's looking at you, and Laban's face didn't look the same way as whenever he used to have conversations with him. Because let me just tell you what's happening. All of a sudden, the only cattle that was bearing children was those that were speckled, spotted, or streaked. And his sons are looking around saying, hold on a second, we got a problem. This Jacob is taking all of our father's goods. He's growing in glory. He's growing in wealth. He's growing in riches. And it's all coming from the hands of our father. In other words, we're losing our inheritance, boys. We got a problem on our hands. And whenever Jacob looked at Laban's face, Laban looked completely different. See, it's how fast the tide turns, right? It's like, oh, you were a blessing yesterday, but now after this deal, you're not so much of a blessing anymore. I can tell you that no matter where you are, no matter where you work, you're going to find people that are going to treat you improperly. They're not going to always do you right. And the reality of it is that it's going to be your job to trust the God that you serve to get you through it. Amen. And if you will trust him, I'm telling you, he will take care of you. It says right here, verse 3, and the Lord said unto Jacob, return unto the land of thy fathers and to thy kindred, and I will be with you. I don't know about you, but no matter what you're in the midst of, you need to be assured that when you go through your trial, God will be with you. Amen. And Jacob sent and called Rachel and Leah to the field unto his flock, and said unto them, I see your father's countenance, that it is not toward me as before, but the God of my father hath been with me. And you know that with all my power, I have served your father. And your father has deceived me and changed my wages 10 times, but God suffered him not to hurt me. If he said thus, and he must have really, Jacob was wanting to be a man of his word. I mean, 10 different times this man deceived him and changed his wages. I mean, let me just stay focused. All right. He may have had Rachel on his mind, but anyway, he did not want to leave. Verse 9, does God have taken away the cattle of your father and given them to me? And it came to pass at the time that the cattle conceived that I lifted up my eyes and I saw in a dream, and behold, the rams which leaped upon the cattle were ringed, straight, speckled, and gristled. And the angel of God spoke unto me in a dream, saying, Jacob, and I said, here am I. And he said, lift up now thine eyes and see all the rams which leap upon the cattle, a ring straight, speckled, and gristled, for I have seen all that Laban doeth unto thee. The God of heaven is watching your life. Sometimes you feel like you've been treated improperly. Listen to me, sometimes I don't want to get ahead of myself, but God will put you in circumstances and situations to get your attention, to turn your eyes back on him. Mm-hmm. But when you are his child and you have a desire to serve him, he's watching everything, and he sees how people treat you. And I'm telling you right now, you have to learn to endure and to trust him in the midst of the trial. And if you will do that, he will get you through, and his will be accomplished in your life, because sometimes he allows those things to happen for a bigger purpose than what you or I can see on the surface. Amen. He says in verse 13, I am the God of Bethel. We're going to go back there in a moment. Because, see, that was even further before in the story. Something happened to Jacob at Bethel. I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed the pillar, and where you vowed a vow unto me. Now arise, get thee out from this land, and return unto the land of thy kindred. And Rachel and Leah answered and said unto him, is there yet any portion or inheritance for us in our father's house? Are we not counted of him strangers? For he hath sold us, and have quite devoured also our money. They're saying, hey, we're married to you. My daddy ain't got nothing left. Basically, he sold us to you. Do what you think is right. Verse 16, for all the riches which God had taken from our father, that is ours and our children's, now then, whatsoever God hath said unto thee, do it. Then Jacob rose up and set his sons and his wives upon camels, and he carried away all his cattle and all his goods, which he had gotten the cattle of his getting, which he had gotten in Padan Aram, for to go to Isaac his father in the land of Canaan. And Laban went to shear his sheep, and Rachel had stolen the images that were her father's. Mm. Images, false gods. Mm-hmm. Rachel was wanting to hold on to something too. It says right here in verse 20, and Jacob stole away unawares to Laban the Syrian, in that he told him not that he fled. In other words, he secretly left at night time. Verse 21, so he fled with all that he had, and he rose up and passed over the river and set his face toward the Mount Gilead. And it was told Laban on the third day that Jacob was fled, and he took his brethren with him and pursued after him 7 days' journey. And they overtook him in the Mount Gilead. I just want you to notice where Laban overtook him in Mount Gilead. We're going to talk about that. And God came to Laban the Syrian in a dream by night and said unto him, take heed that you speak not to Jacob, either good or bad. Then Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the mount, and Laban with his brethren pitched in the Mount of Gilead. And Laban said to Jacob, what hast thou done that thou hast stolen away unawares to me and carried away my daughters as captives taken with a sword? Wherefore didst thou flee away secretly and steal away from me and didst not tell me that I might have sent you away with mirth, meaning rejoicing and singing, with songs, with a tabret, which is a tambourine, or with a harp? So listen, Jacob, why are you taking off in the middle of the night with my daughters? Now, first off, I'd have to say, hold on, father-in-law. Did I work for these women? I mean, aren't they my wives? Did I not marry them? Did I not work for you for 14 years? What in the world are you calling them your daughter for? And you know what, Laban? You probably not ought to not confront everything. I'm starting to learn that, by the way. A soft answer turns away wrath, and probably Jacob did the right thing, but I can see myself confront Laban in this situation. And you lying too, sir, because you ain't wanting to have no party for me, and you're not wanting to have no singing for me, and you're not wanting nobody to beat the tambourine for me. You're mad because I almost got away. You want to destroy me because I saw your countenance change. I'm learning that one. I've been famous all of my life for questioning people on their countenance. Even though sometimes you know what's in their heart, even though sometimes the Lord will show you what's in their heart, it's not always the best thing to do to call them out based upon the facial expression that you see. I'm learning the hard way that sometimes it's best just to let a soft answer turn away wrath. Lord, help me the next time I face that trial so that I can pass it. Amen. So, you know, he's saying that if you would have told me we could have had a party, it has not suffered me to kiss my sons and my daughters. Thou hast now done foolishly in so doing. Then he says this, it is in the power of my hand to do you hurt. In other words, I'm more powerful than you, Jacob. Here you are, smooth-skinned little boy. You got two wives. You got two maidservants. You got 12 kids, and you got a flock of goats. And here I am, big old Laban with a whole bunch of servants. And if I want to, I got a whole lot more power than you, and I'll put a hurting on you. But I had a dream last night. Sometimes you'll feel like you're in the midst of a situation that, you know what, it's bigger than you. But once again, I'm trying to tell you that the God that you serve, he's bigger than it. Amen. And he knows how in the spiritual realm to cause things to move around on your behalf. We just got to learn to trust him. I know sometimes it's hard when we see the physical circumstances. Sometimes it tries to strike fear in our heart. It definitely was striking fear in Jacob's heart. Nevertheless, we have to learn to be able to trust the God that we serve. Amen. That he's able to get us through. Verse 29 is in the power of my hand. But he said, he's in the second part of the verse, your God of your father spoke unto me yesternight, saying, take thou heed that thou speak not to Jacob, either good or bad. And now, though thou wouldest needs be gone, because thou sore longest after thy father's house, yet wherefore hast thou stolen my gods? Jacob answered and said to Laban, because I was afraid, for I said peradventure thou wouldest take by force your daughters from me. So he's answering really why he left first. With whomsoever you find your gods, let him not live before our brethren. Discern thou what is thine with me and take it to thee. For Jacob knew not that Rachel had stolen them. And Laban went into Jacob's tent and into Leah's tent and into the two maidservants' tents, but he found them not. Then went he out of Leah's tent and entered into Rachel's tent. Now Rachel had taken the images and put them in the camel's furniture. It's like a saddle. And put them in the camel's furniture and sat upon them. And Laban searched all the tent, but found them not. And she said to her father, "Let it not displease my lord that I cannot rise up before thee, for the custom of women is upon me." And he searched but found not the images. In other words, she was on her menstrual cycle, and she said it wouldn't be proper for me to stand up, but she was actually hiding those gods underneath her. Verse 36, Jacob was wroth and chode with Laban, and Jacob answered and said to Laban, "What is my trespass? What is my sin that thou hast so hotly pursued after me? Whereas thou hast searched all my stuff, what hast thou found of all thy household? Set it here before my brethren and thy brethren, that they may judge between us both. This 20 years have I been with thee. Thy ewes and the she-goats have not cast their young." In other words, they didn't abort their babies in the field. "When I was with you taking care of your stuff, this is what God did for you. Your cattle did not abort their young. The rams of your flock, I didn't eat them for myself. That which was torn of beasts, I brought not unto you. Instead, I bore the loss of it, and my own hands did thou require it, whether stolen by day or stolen by night." In other words, I wasn't a crybaby for you, Laban. I might have been a smooth-skinned boy and a mama's boy growing up, but I learned some things from my brother Esau, and I toughed it out. And I worked hard for you for 20 years, and I didn't cry to you every time something went. But God, the God that I serve, blessed you in the midst of all of this. I just feel like there's something to learn about work ethic listening to what Jacob's doing. You know, that's why I really kind of wanted to read the story. There's nothing easier to want to do than to quit today's job and think you're going to go find a better one tomorrow, when in reality, you're going to find out in just a little bit of time that this new job isn't any better than the last job, and that every time you chase it around, you're going to find out that sooner or later, at least for me anyway, I had to look in the mirror and look at myself, that maybe the problem is Matt and not everybody else where I'm going. Does that make sense? And or God's just trying to work some things out in me, amen, and I keep running from what it is that he's, amen, trying to do with me. All right? Does that make sense? Yes. If you're somebody that's changed a lot of jobs, I'm not trying to pick on you. I'm just trying to say that maybe there's something else going on. Amen? He says, "Thus I was in the day the drought consumed me, and the frost by night, and my sleep departed from my eyes." Man, I was working hard. I was hungry. I was thirsty. I was cold. I wasn't sleeping. "Thus have I been 20 years in your house. I served you for 14. 14 for your daughters, 6 for your cattle, and thou hast changed my wages 10 times. Except the God of my father, the God of Abraham, the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely thou hast sent me away now empty. God has seen my affliction and the labor of my hands and rebuked you the other night." And Laban answered and said unto Jacob, "These daughters are my daughters. And these children are my children, and these cattle are my cattle, and all that thou seest is mine, and what can I do?" I'm just sitting here thinking, you know, I'm really going to stop reading, and we're about to go, because he makes a covenant with him and stuff. How are you going to reason with this? I mean, how do you reason with this? It's inconceivable. You cannot reason with the logic of this man. Amen. Have you ever been in a conversation with somebody, and you're trying to reason with them, and it's like, what is going on here? Am I a complete idiot? Because it's possible. I suppose it's possible, right? I mean, I thought I had some awareness about me. I thought that I could understand some things. But I'm having this conversation with you, and it's like we are on two completely different pages. Like, I just worked for you for 20 years, man. I worked 14 years for the daughters. I worked 6 years for the cattle. And you're over here going to turn around and say, "This is mine and this is mine." How does that work? Listen, we all need to learn something. You're going to find yourselves in conversations with people sometimes, and especially when it comes to the things of God, and they are going to see things completely different than you do. I don't know about you, but I'm starting to learn a little bit at a time, because I used to just sit there and argue with them. Now's not the time to do it. They're not going to be able to receive. Jesus said, "Don't cast your pearls before swine." Yeah. A swine can't even understand. Listen, a swine doesn't know. I told somebody this the other day. You throw a bunch of pearls in a hog pen, and they're just over there smashing that stuff up in the mud with the snot coming out of their nose, and they're just like, "Give me some slop." They're looking for slop, and they're over there pressing pearls that are like a treasure into the mud. And it's the same thing with a person who has no desire to truly understand the things of God. They're just pressing that stuff up in the mud. It doesn't mean that they'll never come to that place where they're willing to receive. But right then and there, you're wasting your time talking to somebody who cannot even, it's ridiculous, all right? So I want to go back to chapter 28 a little bit. And I want to talk to you a little bit about the big picture of God. Because I want you to see that, you know, real quick, and I don't think we're going to have to be here much longer, but I want you to see that there was originally on this journey, whenever Jacob deceived his brother Esau, and he was on his way to the area where Laban was when he found these two wives, and he went through this whole 20-year process, and then at the end of that, he's going back, right? He's about to meet up with his brother Esau, and he wrestles with God. On his way on the journey, on the front end, before he ever had one wife, much less two, he stopped in this place that he ended up calling it Bethel, and he had a dream. As a matter of fact, I'm just going to tell you the story of the dream. He stops at this place, and he lays his head down, and in this place, he has a dream. And the dream that he has is that heaven is open, and there's a ladder that's descending from heaven to earth. And upon this ladder, there are angels that are ascending and descending. So what we're seeing is this, basically, if we could take a little bit of time and think about it. We're seeing an open heaven, and we're seeing a connection point between heaven and earth. And we're seeing that which is of heaven coming down to earth, and earth almost being able to have an access to the things of heaven. So there's an access point that's taking place here. And in the midst of that dream, God begins to tell Jacob that, you know what, the same promise, essentially, this is what he said, the same promise that I gave your father Abraham, I'm also giving it to you. I'm going to give you a people. Your seed is going to be more than the dust of the entirety of the earth, and you're going to multiply from the east and the west and the north and the south. Now, I'm going to give you the interpretation of that scripture. And I know I've had a lot of conversations with people that are like, well, that's your interpretation. No, I'm about to give you the interpretation, and I can prove it to you. Sometimes it might just sound right, but today it is right. Amen? And what I want you to know is that access point, what God was telling Jacob 2,000 years before Jesus would ever been born, we're talking about the big picture of God. You need to understand that as a believer, you have given your life over to the Lord. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I don't need you to raise your hand. You know whether you did or not. If you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you bowed your knee and said, yes, Lord, I say yes to you. I give my life to you. I believe the plan is real. I believe I was born a sinner, and I believe I need a Savior. And I believe that the answer for man's sin was that you sent your son, Jesus, who had no sin, who was righteous, and shed his innocent blood in my place, and now I put my faith in that. I receive you into my heart. I ask forgiveness of my sins. I want to go your way, God. You might not have said it just like that. You might have just said, Lord, I'm a sinner. And I believe that you died for me, Jesus. You can't get saved if you haven't come to the conclusion that you're a sinner. Hello? Is it still okay to tell the truth in the church? You can't get saved if you didn't realize that you needed salvation. But if you did that, then you know what I'm talking about. I preached it last week. The cement sacks fell off your back. And you felt the presence of God now in your life. Amen. Well, now you belong to God. You belong to God. You were purchased with a price through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. You're not your own. You belong to Him. And so in the big picture of God, we need to understand that our lives have to line up with the big picture of God. And the big picture of God is that He wants folks saved. Amen. God wants people saved. And He wants to use your life, not just a preacher. Come on now, somebody. This isn't some little situation, I don't know if I should do this, but where you shrink down, where you can shrink down a preacher and you stick him in your pocket and then you put him on the table and you pour a little water on him and he grows up and he gets all big and he's like, okay, preacher, get him. No, that's not how it works. God wants to use you. He wants to use you as a vessel. He wants the Holy Ghost that lives on the inside of you, where you're at the workplace, where you're at Walmart, wherever you are. And you might not do it like me. You might not get loud and boisterous. You might not get passionate and veins pop out of your forehead. But He wants to use you. He wants to let Jesus come out of you. And He wants people to know that God is real. You might do it real quiet, but hallelujah, if you do it, you do it. Amen. He wants you to be a witness. He wants you to be a reflection. That song y'all were singing, Lord, I magnify your name or something. While you were singing it, I was thinking, man, I want to be a magnifying glass. I want to be a magnifying glass to where when the light of God shines through me, Jesus just looks real, real big. When other people are looking through me, I know it doesn't always happen, but that's what I want. When people are looking through me, I want Jesus to look real, real big. Amen. I talked to somebody recently, like, dude, you ain't functioning properly in this world. You ain't functioning properly in this society. The reality of it is that your addiction to Jesus is messing you all up. You can't. But you know what? You know what the problem is? The problem is this. Is that whenever I do talk about the Lord, sometimes what ends up happening is that I hope anyway, Jesus is looking real, real big. Amen. And maybe in some people's eyes, that's starting to look real, real Amen. Foolish and small. And maybe in some people's eyes, that doesn't sit right with them. It doesn't feel, and I understand that because there was a time in my life when I wanted Matt to look real, real big. And like John the Baptist said, I must decrease so that he might increase. Amen.
Amen.
The point that I'm trying to make is that you're not your own. And as the big plan of God, we're talking about an open heaven. We're talking about a ladder from heaven to earth. We're talking about that which is of heaven connecting that which is the earth. In John chapter 1, you got your dot Bibles? I need you to read this one. I want you to look at it. I want you to see it with your eyes. John chapter 1, verse 51. This is the beginning in the Gospel of John. And all of the disciples are following Jesus. And John the Baptist had two disciples. One was John, one was Andrew. Andrew told his brother Peter. And then Andrew and Peter found Philip in Galilee where they were fishermen. And then now they're heading to another area. And all of a sudden they find Nathaniel under a fig tree reading the Word of God. At least that's what we believe he was doing based on certain circumstances. And all of a sudden Nathaniel comes over there to Jesus. And Jesus tells Nathaniel in verse 51. And he says unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Now, do you realize what just happened right there? We just got an interpretation from the master himself of Jacob's dream when he was heading to go find his wife 2,000 years before. And every Israelite that had read this word of God time and again, you might not have caught the connection the first time. I certainly didn't catch the connection the first time. But hallelujah, Nathaniel caught the connection. You're the fulfillment of Jacob's dream. Yes, I am. Jacob's on a journey. He got to go get a wife because he's got to have offspring. Because the offspring are going to swell into a great nation. And this great nation, and people all of a sudden, he's going to be a blessing. Through your seed, all nations of the earth shall be blessed. You're going to be a people that are greater than the dust of the entirety of the earth. They're going to come from the east. They're going to come from the west. They're going to come from the north. They're going to come from the south. Because out of you, Jacob, I'm going to fulfill the promise that I gave your grandfather Abraham. And I'm going to make you a great nation. And through that nation, I'm going to give Jesus. And Jesus is going to be the access point between heaven and earth. Because he's going to die on a cross. And he's going to remove the sin of humanity. And whenever he does that, then the multitudes are going to come in. The multitudes that are born sinners of Adam are going to have their sin forgiven. And they're going to be able to have a relationship with the Holy One of Israel. And their numbers are going to be greater than the dust of the earth. And they're going to come from the east and the west and the north and the south. And your seed is going to be the seed of you. Jesus, one seed, is going to be the blessing of all the nations of the earth. That's the promise that God gave to Jacob. Hallelujah, the promise of Messiah, the promise of Jesus. And so Jacob is on this journey. But I want you to see, he's on this journey, but he's also got his own individual life. And just as you and I are going to leave here today, tomorrow we're going to face circumstances just like Jacob's face. Real quick, what I want you to see is that people are clinging to stuff in this story. First off, Laban. We see through Laban's actions, I believe, that Laban, he wants to cling to a lifestyle. I mean, he's mad about the gods, but let's be real here. He's still calling the women, the girls, his daughters. He's still calling the cattle his cattle. And Laban likes, he said it in that one in chapter 30. At the end, he said, I can see, I recognize what's going on here. The God that you serve is blessing me on your account. And when he realizes Jacob's gone, he's seeing the spigot turn off and the blessings running dry. And he doesn't like it at all. You know, the reality of it is that there's a lot of people, come on somebody, you know what I'm talking about. There's a lot of people that say they want to serve God, but in reality they want to serve the blessings that the God brings. And they're not really wanting to serve the God of the blessing, they're wanting to serve the blessings of the God. The problem that you have with that is this. Job said in chapter 1, verse 21, God gives and he takes away. And as long as God's giving, he's a good old God. Oh man, I'm blessed. I love my God. But as soon as he starts taking away, he's not so good anymore. And the next thing you know, we want to leave him. And we want to turn our back on him. Well, no. I want to encourage you. Don't be like Laban. Don't focus on just the blessings of God. Amen? That was Laban. It says, and then I was thinking about Leah. Poor Leah, she's clinging to Jacob. You know, I mean, there's nothing wrong with a woman wanting love of her husband. I understand that. But poor Leah, I mean, she's clinging to Jacob like he's God. She's miserable. And no matter what she does, she cannot cause Jacob to love her the way that she wants to be loved by that man. And I just got to tell you something, that no matter how powerful or beautiful human love can be, it's never going to do you right on this side of the eternal veil. And let me tell you why. Because you got a Jesus hole in your heart. Amen. You understand that? I'm not saying when you put Jesus in the hole that you're never going to have anything bad happen to you, because then I'd be a lying preacher. What I'm trying to say is that there's a Jesus hole in your heart. And when you try to stick it in another relationship in there, does anybody know what I'm talking about? Has anybody, you don't have to raise your hand, just kind of nod your head a little bit with blink your eyes. Relationship after relationship after relationship after relationship after relationship. And you never fulfill you. Because it's like trying to stick a square inside of a round hole. You ever seen a kid try to do that? It don't fit. And even if you try to jam it in there, if you get the hammer out, you start beating that thing, and even if you forced it and wedged it in there, it still don't feel right. Because it's a Jesus hole. And you got to put Jesus in the hole, amen? And so I just want to encourage you to realize that no matter how hard you try, I'm not saying that God won't give you a good relationship. I'm not saying that he won't bring that stuff together for you. That's not what I'm getting at. What I'm trying to say is, if you continue to find all your fulfillment and happiness in that other relationship, you are going to be let down and you're going to be feeling real empty. And I just want you to know that Leah is trying to cling to Jacob. As a matter of fact, I remember to tell you what the title of my message was, but it's supposed to be Reduced to Clinging. Remember what we talked about last week in our story? We talked about a story on Wednesday, and we taught the book of Ruth. And in the book of Ruth, there were names that meant something. There were places that meant, the names of the places meant something. But Ruth's name was friend, and the other sister-in-law, the other daughter-in-law, her name was Orpah. Orpah means gazelle. Whenever everybody's husband died, because everybody's husband died, they were in disobedience. They were on a journey too, and they went in the wrong direction. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law and she ran the other way, just like a gazelle. Ruth was a friend. And the Bible says she clave to Naomi. Clave is old King James English for clinging. Ruth clinged to Naomi. She was clinging to Naomi, but she was clinging because she wanted to serve the God of Naomi. Amen? And in this morning's message, I want you to know that everybody's clinging to something. Laban's clinging to his old way of life. Leah's clinging to Jacob. Rachel clings to her father's gods. And, you know, while these gods certainly represent false religion, they do also represent a false understanding of God and his ways. And what I mean by that is that I've talked to multiple people about the things of God. And I've had conversations with people, and they probably didn't like my personality, and that's my fault. You know, I pray God help me, you know. Some people love my personality, some people don't like it, some people hate it. Some people love it sometimes and hate it at other times. You know, it's just who I am. But I do pray. I want you to know I pray and I ask God, change the parts of me that need to be changed. So I want people to hate me, but at the same time, I always want to tell the truth.
Amen.
And if I'm over here telling the truth about the Bible and somebody gets their feathers ruffled about it, I can't really help that. But I've had multiple conversations with people and they're like, I don't agree with the way that you see the Bible. Because when I hear the Bible, I think I'm supposed to feel good. I think that when I hear the Bible, I'm supposed to be leaving feeling good about myself and that I should be full of joy. And there's many times that you will be encouraged by the Word of God. Amen. It will fill you up. It will lift you up. But I got to tell you something. I hope I can say this and get away with it. If you think that every time you hear the Word of God, you're going to leave out of there feeling good about yourself, you need to turn off Joel Osteen and you need to crack open the Scriptures. I'm just saying this. You know, the truth of the gospel is something different. Amen. Come on, somebody. Help me out here.
Amen.
Because, listen to me, something happens when the true Word of God goes forth.
Amen.
When the preacher will yield his tongue to the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit will ride on the words of the Word of God, what will happen is that you won't feel good about yourself.
Amen.
What's going to happen is that many times the Holy Spirit will begin to convict you of yourself.
Yes.
What does the word conviction mean? It means the Holy Spirit is dealing with you. It means he's reaching down in your heart and he's stimulating stuff and he's showing you stuff on the inside of you that's not right. He's saying, hey, we got to deal with this. That's what God does. He works through the Word and the Holy Spirit. He deals with stuff. Amen?
Amen.
And so, listen to me. Rachel, she's holding on to a false understanding of the ways of God by trying to hold on to the gods of her father Laban. And I know I'm maybe taking a little bit of liberty, but I'm just trying to say that many times in the modern church, people are holding on to a false understanding of God and His ways. Let me give you another example. Not only is the Word of God not always going to make you feel good about yourself. As a matter of fact, the Word of God wants you to be able to see yourself. Amen. But that's another story. But sometimes people have an improper understanding of how they make themselves right with God. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but this is a problem that has been in the church for a long time. And we have a lot of guests today. And so I want to make sure that we're clear on this, because this is what we teach in this church. The same way you received in my preaching last week, I know I'm not getting old. The same way you received Him, so shall you continue to walk in Him. You received Him by faith. Faith in what? Faith in what Jesus did for you at the cross. Because see, that's what made what was wrong between you and God, your sin, go away. And brought you back to Him. Brought you back to His presence. So now each and every day, the same way you received Him through faith in what He did, is the same way you walk in Him.
Amen.
Each and every day you approach God from this position. Now sometimes it takes a little while for you to allow your mindset to be changed to this, for your mind to be renewed to this truth. Because the truth of the matter is that all of our lives were trained to become independent. Is that not true? I mean, Ballard, when your kids were young, you tried to get them potty trained, right? You don't want kids walking around in diapers for the rest of their lives. Then we hurry up, we send them to school. I told Sierra, look, boo, you need to find your man of God. I'm just saying. You want to find somebody that really, really loves Jesus, okay? Because, you know, there's a whole lot of guys out there that they're church boys, but they don't really, really love Jesus, you know, whatever. But ultimately, you got to find that. But in the meantime, I can't pay your bills all your life. I changed it. I'm not gonna, because it just ain't. I'm not gonna do it, because I'm not. So you need to go to school, but at the same time, you know. So I'm over here trying to get her to some place where one day she can be a little bit independent, right? There is some truth to that. She needs to be a little bit independent, but in the economy of God, it's the opposite. He wants you to be dependent upon Him. And so all of our life, we're being trained mentally to become independent so that we can take care of ourselves. But in the economy of God, He's saying, unless you come up to me as a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
And so what God's wanting you and I to do, as far as for our righteousness and our walk with Him, is to remain dependent upon Him, understanding, listen to me, this is where the rubber meets the road. You can't read enough of this book right here to make yourself righteous in the eyes of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We got 3 services a week over here, and this week coming up, we're going to have 4 services this week. Saturday night, don't forget, we got a guest speaker. It's going to be a good time. Bring some people with you, all right? Listen to me. I don't care how many services you go to, you cannot, by going to church, make yourself righteous in the eyes of God. You cannot read enough, you can't go to church enough, you can't even pray enough to make yourself righteous in the eyes of God. There's only one thing that can make you righteous in the eyes of God, and that is His beloved Son, who had no sin and died on a cross and allowed a transference of guilt. He took your guilt upon Him, and He exchanged His righteousness unto you, and all that was done on faith. And it says in Romans chapter 4, what hath our father Abraham found according to the flesh? What does that mean? Did Abraham find something from God based on works, flesh, physical work? No, but by faith. Abraham found it by faith. God said this unto Abraham. Abraham believed it, and it was accounted unto him as righteousness. That's a big thing, right?
Amen.
You got to understand, improper understanding of the scriptures, improper understanding of how to walk with God will cause you to try to approach God through all of your works. You know what that becomes? It's called self-righteousness. You become like a Pharisee. I read more than everybody in the church.
Okay.
Listen to me, man. Don't tell me you ain't ever done it, because I've done it, and if I did it, you did it. I think you did it.
Amen.
I'm over here worshiping the Lord. One lady, we get in front of the camera. I'm over here worshiping the Lord. I got 2 hands up. I look over there. He only got 1. Oh, man. I'm a better Christian than him. I got 2 hands. I got 2 hands in the air. He's only got 1. Come on, dude. You got to get with the program. You're not righteous enough. That's a completely improper understanding of anything having to do with the things of God.
Amen.
And the man don't even want to stand up during worship. Leave him alone. He's in church. Amen. Hallelujah. But if he wants to take off running, leave him alone. He's in church and he's excited for Jesus.
Amen.
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 And so all I'm trying to say is this, is you can't earn it. That's an improper understanding. Amen. Rachel's clinging to an improper understanding of God. Don't cling to an improper understanding of God. Amen?
Amen.
Jacob. Jacob clings to his old ways. I mean, listen. He had a revelation from God. He saw the big picture of God. You know, God has a purpose for his life. He's in the past, he's deceived his brother Esau twice. And now he's coming back and he's told in the story that his brother Esau is ahead of him. Right? And what does he do? He goes back to thinking. His little neurons are firing. He's like, got to come up with a plan. What are we going to do? Okay, I got it. Take Leah, put her here, put Rachel over here, split the kids up, split the flocks up, send this one in that direction, send that one in that direction, and I'll stay behind. And whichever one Esau gets, I'll have the other one. He's probably like, well, I'm not going to do that.
Yeah.
I think I've said that before. He's probably praying the wrong way. If somebody won't get it, let him get Leah. But nevertheless, what's ended up happening is he split them up, and he's coming up with his own plan. But then the Bible says what in verse 24? Let's go back to Genesis chapter 31, verse 24. So Jacob is trying to once again do things the way that he used to do things. He's holding on to his old ways. He's holding on to his old ways of thinking. I got this. I'm going to figure this out. Jacob right now is a perfect representation of the flesh, figuring it out in his own strength. Verse 32, chapter 32, verse 24. It says right here, and Jacob, I'm sorry, let's start in verse 22. And he arose up that night and took his two wives and his two women servants and his 11 sons, and he passed over the Ford Jabbok. Before we move forward and read it, just hold on with me, please. I know I keep doing that to you. I apologize. Two things I want to tell you. Number one, do you remember the place where Laban caught up with Jacob? I told you to remember. It was called Gilead. The word Gilead means rocky region. All right? And so what I want you to see in this particular situation is that Jacob has... This is some stressful stuff, man. I mean, try to imagine yourself. You ever feel like you're being pressed from both sides in some situations? Jacob's in the midst of some stressful stuff. He's got Laban riding his backside, meeting up with him in the rocky region. Sometimes we're going through things in our life and we find ourselves in a rocky region. It's real hard to travel in a rocky region. And we're wondering, Lord, why in the world do you have me in this rocky region? So as soon as he gets done with his situation with Laban, he turns around and his red-headed brother Esau is coming at him from the front end. The Bible says he crosses over the Jabbok, and the word Jabbok means emptying. Sometimes that's why God has us in a rocky region, because he's trying to bring us to a place where he can empty us of ourselves, amen, so that he can put Jesus back in us. And that's what happens in the midst of this circumstance right here. Jacob crosses over the Jabbok, and the verse 24 says, and Jacob was left alone, and there he wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. Now we remember what happens in this story, right? What happens in this story is that Jacob holds on to the Lord, and he says, I will not let you go until you bless me. And what happens is this, the blessing results in two things. It results in a name change, and it results in a change in the way that Jacob walked. Number one, I want you to know in the New Testament, the word name literally means character. Jacob's name originally meant deceiver. Jacob's name change meant prince of God, or one who rules with God. See, because God's plan for Jacob was that as Israel, amen, would be the people of God, and one day God is going to literally rule on his throne from the place known as Israel, which received the name with Jacob's name change. God wants to change your name. He wants to change our name from whoever we were before, the old man, Paul called him, to a new man in Christ. Amen? And the way that he does that is he allows the Holy Spirit to come live in us, and it's a process. Listen to me, at the end of today's service, Ballard and the guys are going to sing a song, and we're going to always have the altar open for people to come pray. And to be honest with you, if you need prayer for anything, I'll stand, partner with you, hold your hand, pray with you. But listen to me, how many times you ever went up to an altar and somebody laid their hands on you, you thought you were supposed to fall down and you got back up and you were the same way that you were before whenever you stood up there. All I'm trying to tell you is this. I believe in being slain in the Holy Spirit, but I can't tell you how many times I've fallen down, and I hate to admit it. I'm just going to be real with you. I'm just a real preacher. Sometimes I fell down because I thought that's what I was supposed to do. Twice I know that I fell down. I believe the power of God will hit people and knock them down. I'm just being real. I'm not trying to mess up your theology, but I'm trying to tell you this, that changing is a process. The Holy Spirit living in you, yes. The Holy Spirit working through the Word of God will change you. Amen. Give God some time. Keep on coming back and let the Lord work in you. Amen. Some things happen right away. Some things it takes some time. Amen. And so, listen, though, Jacob's name was changed. His character was changed. He went from being Jacob, the supplanter, heel snatcher, deceiver, to Israel, Prince of God. Amen. God wants to make you a prince. He wants to use you in his kingdom. Amen. Second thing that was changed was his walk. Now, typically, you would think that a limp would cause somebody's walk to be messed up, but that's just like God likes it. God wants the glory for himself. He doesn't want man getting the glory. And Jacob, just from that day, he just limped everywhere that he went. But you know what a limp will do for somebody like that? It'll remind him of that night he wrestled with God. Amen. It'll remind him of that night that he wrestled with God. He said, I refuse to let go of you until you bless me. All right, Jacob, you want to bless me? Bam, right there. I'm going to touch you in the hollow of your thigh. I'm going to knock your hip out of joint. And you will never walk the same. Listen to me. When the Lord gets a hold of you, you'll never walk the same. I'm not trying to say you're going to be perfect, because the truth of the matter is there was only one who was perfect. His name was Jesus. But you will never walk the same. Listen, everybody's clinging to something in this story. We don't want to be like Laban and cling to a former way of life, because you might have a whole lot today and you might not have anything tomorrow. We want to learn to cling to something that's not going to change.
Eternal.
We don't want to cling like Leah to a relationship, because people are going to let you down. Even though they love you, even though they care about you, in some way, shape, or form, they're going to let you down. And then the next thing you know, you're going to be expecting things out of people that God never intended for you to expect out of people. God's something else, Lord. I hope it's okay for me to say that. God will allow people to do some crazy stuff in your life, amen, just so you can realize,
amen,
that you can't hold on to them and trust them. They're going to mess you up. Come on. And then once again, it doesn't mean they don't care about you. It doesn't mean that you don't forget them. But the reality of it is that they're not going to fit that little hole that's in your heart.
Right.
Amen. Amen. Don't be like Rachel. Mm-hmm. Hold on to an improper understanding of the things of God. Instead, ask the Lord, Lord, show me what your word is really saying. Teach me your ways. Even if sometimes it doesn't feel good, I appreciated that. I was talking to Danny, I can't remember if it was yesterday at the health club or the other day. You're like, no, you know what, Matt? Sometimes when people tell the truth, it ruffles people's feathers. But guess what? It might be a year later. It might be 2 months later. You got to tell the truth. Amen. And believe God that it's going to come back around and do. See, the Lord said, my word will not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that which it was set forth to do. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And the truth of the word will accomplish God's will, amen?
That's right.
So we don't want to be like Laban. We don't want to be like Leah. We don't want to be like Rachel. We don't want to be like Jacob and try to figure everything out in our own logic and try to do it all with our own hands. We want to be like Israel, amen?
Amen.
To cling to something that doesn't move. I want to close with at least one passage of Scripture, and I'll just tell you, if you happen to be taking notes, I don't know if anybody is, but the other one was going to be Matthew chapter 7. Verses 21 through 27, and you can go read that later. It talks about a rock and about building your house on a rock, and it talks about other circumstances. We're going to turn to Hebrews 6, though, is where we're going. And it talks about other people. It talks about the difference between building your house on a rock and other people that build their house on the sand. And that sand shifts. It's movable, but that the rock doesn't move. All right? So Hebrews 6...
Matthew?
No, actually, I'm sorry. I told you Matthew 7, verse 21 through 27, if you were taking notes and you wanted to read it later. And I was explaining it as you were turning to Hebrews chapter 6. Sorry, I got too many things going on. So we'll just slow down and let everybody get to Hebrews 6. And you'll realize that God's even using your preacher in your life as a trial, because you don't even know which passage to go to. I know he's using me in my father-in-law's life. But we're going to take our time, and we're going to just let you get to Hebrews 6. All right? Hebrews 6, verse 18. So what I was trying to tell you about the Matthew passage, though, is that some people build their house on the sand, and the sand shifts, it moves. Leah's clinging to something that moves. Laban's clinging to something that moves. You get the point. Build your house on the rock, which is Jesus. The rock doesn't move. All right, Hebrews chapter 6. It says in verse 18 that by two immutable things. Now, he's talking about when he gave a promise to Abraham. And he's saying that two immutable things, the word immutable means changing, non-changing. I'm sorry. The word immutable means it doesn't change. The two non-changing things that it's talking about is the fact that God gave a promise and he also put himself to an oath. When God gives a promise and he puts himself to an oath, it doesn't change. You understand that? If you give me a promise or you give me an oath, I hope it doesn't happen. Or if I do the same to you, it may change. But when God does it, it doesn't change. It's rock solid. It's graven in stone that will never fade away. That by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Whither the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus, made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now, what does that mean? That's a lot of information. The Old Testament tabernacle or temple, you all know, there was a veil. There was a veil that separated the holy place from the most holy, and behind the veil there was the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the presence of God. When Jesus died on the cross, what we heard is that there was, what the scripture says is that there was an earthquake, Matthew 27:51, that split the veil in half, signifying that now entrance into the presence of God was for everybody. Before, only the high priest could go in once a year and he would have to offer blood on the mercy seat. What this scripture is saying is that Jesus is our forerunner, that he entered through the veil. And now, if you could even just, I know the veil's ripped, but I just want you to imagine a veil. And I want you to imagine a rope. I want you to imagine an anchor on the inside. You can't even see the anchor. The anchor's on the other side of the veil. You can't see it, all right? And that anchor holds. What it's saying is that this is an immovable anchor. It doesn't matter how bad the storm is outside. You ever been on a boat? You ever been on a work boat before? Some of you guys might have been on a work boat or like a big fishing boat, and the storms get bad, and you might be tied off to a rig or something like that. And all of a sudden, you know, the swell's coming. It's like, pop, and it causes that nylon rope to pop like that, and it just looks so angry and so vicious. And that's a lot of times how the storms seem on the outside. And it's like, I'm telling you right now, that rope's popping. Sometimes you probably get scared. I know nylon's strong, but sometimes it's like, man, can this rope really hold? What I can tell you is that it doesn't matter how bad the storm is on the outside, the anchor that went in behind the veil, it doesn't move. And just like Jacob clinging to the Lord that night, you and I need to be assured that the anchor holds. Amen. This anchor will not move. And you and I need to learn to cling to the immovable. His name is Jesus. No matter what you're going through, in the midst of relationships, in the midst of your finances, in the midst of everyday life, as you're dealing with things, people coming against you, people lying about you. Come on, somebody, has that ever happened to anybody in here? People treating you improperly, right? Listen to me. Sometimes it becomes so difficult, and the enemy wants to cause bitterness to rise up in the midst of your heart. He wants to cause anger to rise up in the midst of your heart. I'm here to tell you, you have to trust the Lord and hold on to him. The anchor will not move. Amen. The anchor holds.